Welcome to St. Paul's Lutheran Church's Weekly Worship Podcast. As always, we're broadcasting from beautiful Grand Island, Nebraska. The following traditional worship service was recorded on Sunday, April 23, 2017, at our 9 o'clock service. The sermon was delivered by Pastor Bill Pavuk. Please visit us online at www.stpaulsgi.com.
Congregation, please stand as we begin our procession. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, wait a second. Alleluia! Christ is risen. I knew something was missing. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia.
Lord be with you.
And also
with you. Let's pray. Almighty and eternal God, the strength of those who believe, the hope of those who doubt, may we who have not seen have faith in you and receive the fullness of Christ's blessing. The one who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit as one God, now and forever. Amen. And we pray together for our call committee and their support teams. Gracious God, we give thanks for those who have been appointed to serve on the call committee and its support teams. They are entrusted with the work of discerning a new faith formation director for our congregation. Grant to these men and women wisdom, patience, and the direction of your Holy Spirit, that they may exercise right judgment and so serve you and the mission of your people here. Amen. Congregation may be seated. Thank you, Terry. Invite the children to come forward for a moment with them. Come on up, kids. Good morning, everybody. How are we doing? Happy Easter. You know, it's still Easter. It's going to be Easter for like 5 more weeks. It's going to be Easter for like 5 more weeks. So you can keep saying Happy Easter to people. True story. I brought something for us to share today. Smell. Brought something for us to share. But I thought, lots of times we share things, you know, there's lots of times that we share food by eating, by all of us eating it. But I thought, how about if we shared it this way? How about if we shared these peanut butter cups by me eating them and then telling you about it? That's sharing, right? That's sharing. Oh, that mix of chocolate and peanut butter, and it's a little bit crunchy on the outside. It's like hard. And then you bite through it, and then it gets soft. Yeah, we'll see if this one is that way too. You pretty sure it's going to be that way? Go ahead. We'll get to you later. We'll get to you guys later. Well, that was exciting. Oh, now this one's kind of soft on the top. So that's kind of different. Ooh, can't wait to tell you about this one. This isn't really a good way of sharing, is it? It's not the same, is it? Not the same. You're not really interested in hearing about other people enjoying something, are you? Be better if you got to share it yourself, right? Right? Yeah. Well, fortunately, we have that option. Wait, you were saying that you've already had these, so you don't want another one, do you? Yeah, sure. Here you go. Well, the reason I decided to play a little bit with sharing is that in our Bible story this morning, Jesus appeared to all of his disciples. All of them. Well, not quite. There was one disciple who wasn't at the party. I thought so. Come here, sweetheart. There was one disciple who wasn't at the party. So he came back, and everybody else said, "Hey, we're going to share what we had with you." So they told him about it. And it was kind of like you guys hearing about peanut butter cups. It was like, well, his reaction was kind of like, well, thanks a lot, but I'd rather experience it for myself. Because there are things that aren't the same if we just hear somebody talking about them. Sometimes that's just not enough. And we have known the love of Jesus. We have felt the love of Jesus. We have touched the love of Jesus in the lives of others. And we get to have it, and we get to share it with others. And we don't want to share it by just telling them about it. We want them to be able to have that love for themselves. And that was what Jesus' friend Thomas wanted too. He wanted to really have what his friends got to have. And we want God to help us find that for ourselves and for other people. Can you pray with me? Lord God, help us to experience you. Help us to know from your presence the truth and the power and the promise of your resurrection and your life in us. Amen. All right. Thanks for coming up. Jack, we missed you up there.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. You that are the Israelites, listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of powers, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you. As you yourselves know, this man handed over to you, according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Fellow Israelites, I may say to you confidently of our ancestor David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on his throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that, all of us are witnesses. The word of the Lord.
Thank you, God. Keep me safe, O God. I run for dear life to you. I say to God, be my Lord. Without you, nothing makes sense. Don't just go shopping for a God. Gods are not for sale. I swear I'll never treat God names like brand names. The wise counsel God gives when I'm awake is confirmed by my sleeping heart. Day and night, I'll stick with God. I've got a good thing going, and I'm not letting go. Now you've got my feet on the life path, all radiant from the shining of your face. Ever since you took my hand, I'm on the right way.
A reading from the first lesson of Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Please stand. Holy Gospel according to St. John in the 20th chapter. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And after he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, the one who is called the twin, who is one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." Thomas said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, put my finger in the mark on his hand, and put my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. And although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hand. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ. Congregation may be seated. Christ is risen. Well, you may have figured out from the children's message already that I'm not going to be talking about Thomas's doubting much. Personally, I'd be lying if I said that I didn't ache and demand and want badly to experience that transforming presence of Christ over and over again. So I'm not about to come up here and look down on Thomas for wanting every bit of what his friends had known. Pastor Edgar asked last week in his Easter message something that I hope that everybody spent this week reflecting on and considering. when we come to Easter, what are we looking for? What are we wanting? What are we seeking from Easter? Like him, I want to know about that real stone, and I want to know a real resurrection. And like Thomas, I last week came here wanting to touch and to experience the risen Lord, that Christ is alive. And I don't know about the rest of you, but I wasn't disappointed. Today I want to talk about the closed and locked doors of that upper room. I want to talk about where Jesus finds the disciples in this Easter experience and what he does with it. The disciples gather in the evening on that day, it says, the first day of the week. The day that began with Peter and John running to the tomb after Mary told them that Christ was not there, that Christ is risen. It happened. This event that Jesus told them was going to occur finally happened. Jesus told them a handful of times, at least, that this was going to occur. Several times it's recorded in the Gospels where Jesus says to the disciples that the Son of Man must suffer and die and in 3 days rise from the dead. And several times in the Gospels, the disciples receive Jesus' words about this with something similar to, la 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 la, can't hear you. It was too much to handle. It was too much for them to understand. There's points where it says they outright told him to stop saying it, that they didn't want to hear it, that they weren't ready, that they couldn't grasp that this could happen. But it happened. The script and the rules about how everything was supposed to work, about what was possible and what wasn't possible, all of that was done now. Easter morning had brought about a reset. Easter morning had brought about a reset, not for their lives, not for their religion. Easter morning had brought a reset for all of creation. Life and death, as they had known it, was over. Christ is risen. Hallelujah. So that was the morning. But Easter morning had given way to Easter afternoon and Easter evening. And with that came the realization that the empty tomb, marvelous and incredible as it was, it had changed nothing about a lot of their circumstances. To the religious leaders that sent Jesus to the cross, they were still co-conspirators, just as they were the day before, just as they were on Good Friday, just as they would be on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday. Pilate had reluctantly gone along with their plans to take their leader, a leader who had once told them, if this is what they do to the leader, what will they do to the followers? And whatever good might come from the empty tomb, those religious leaders were still clearly going to be very eager to make someone pay for this. So it changed nothing about the threats that hung over them. It changed nothing about the chaos and the uncertainty in their hearts and minds about what comes next. Like I said, there's no script for this. It changed nothing about the sense that it was them against the rest of the world. They knew what happened. The women knew what happened. But nobody else really knew, really understood, really had any idea of what they now knew. So they gathered that night. They gathered that night, the first hours of Christ's victory, with the doors locked, shut away from everything that the tomb hadn't changed. But through those locked doors came the Prince of Peace, the one that they watched suffer and die. And I wonder, I imagine before Jesus came into that room and showed himself to them, I wonder if in that room that night they were still replaying in their heads the last looks, the last words, the last moments that they'd had with him. Just as they were feeling the weight of everything that had happened those last few days, and just as they were feeling the weight and the strain of the darkness that was still, the darkness and fear that was still not far from them, the risen Lord appeared before them and changed everything. The threats, the uncertainties, the disconnect and distance that they felt from the rest of all that they'd known, those things were still there. But in the face of this, Jesus opened his arms and his hands, and he breathed on them those words of peace. And now, though nothing had changed, at the same time, everything had changed. Because they knew that his peace was enough. They knew that the truth that they had received and would soon be sent to share was enough. Because the life that they had in Christ, the life that began anew for all of creation when Jesus from the cross said, "It is accomplished." That life was everything now. Because a life that outshines the hardest hearts, a life that outshines the cruelest betrayals and attacks, a life that brings freedom to our spirits in the coldest prisons, that life was everything now. Because the hands that bled for them, the body that was broken for them, that had overcome for them, and that would continue to overcome for them, that was everything now. Because the truth that confounded the empire and the religious leaders, the truth that they thought that they could crush, just as they'd crushed their opposition in the past, that truth was everything. And for us, well, I can only speak for me. Maybe Easter afternoon and Easter evening continued that elation and that contagious joy that we had here on Saturday evening, gathered around this font by candlelight, bringing in new members, and then Sunday morning with the Easter celebrations. Maybe it continued into the evening for you. It did for me. I didn't get my pastor nap on Sunday. That's how keyed up I was. I was so uplifted and energized by that presence, by that encounter with Christ. But then there was Monday. And with Monday, suddenly, all that the empty tomb on Sunday had sort of held at bay, those things started to crop up again. In many ways, all that was daunting and intimidating and anxiety-inducing before Holy Week, well, it was all still there. And in the world around us, the hostilities, the divisions, the bitterness and the judgments, They didn't go away. It's almost like the world didn't hear. It's almost like we want to say, haven't you heard? Don't you know that the stone was rolled away? Don't they know that they have been set free from these cycles of ungrace? But everything is different. Everything is different because we know. Because we know that these things that oppose the light of the resurrection, we know that they're as good as finished. Because we know that the forgiveness, that forgiveness and mercy are going to have their way. Because we know that other kingdoms, other powers, other ways of showing force, we know that these things are part of a different age. That their claims on our lives are simply out of touch. Because we know that while there are still monstrous battles ahead of us, because while we know that there's still evil, and while we know that there are still heartaches in this world, we know that we have the one who can reach us and who can lift us up. Because we know that the wounds and the scars that we bear don't change the truth and the life that is for us. We know this because we have seen His wounds. We've seen His wounds in our own lives. We've seen His wounds in the lives of others. We know how He is with us. We know this because we have tasted His goodness and His grace and how it sustains us and gives us life and hope of peace beyond all else. We know this because we know the empty tomb. We know the one who was wounded for us and continues to suffer with and for us. We know the joy and the triumph and truth that is found in His gospel like no other. And knowing this is everything. Christ is risen. Amen. Let's stand and sing together.
whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church.
When we come to Easter, what are we looking for? What are we wanting? What are we seeking from Easter? Like him, I want to know about that real stone, and I want to know a real resurrection.
We pray for the church. Breathe your Spirit into us. Renew us with your power. Unite us in mission, and send us into the world with your love. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for the earth, for fields and forests, gardens and vineyards, and all newly planted crops. Sustain our world with clean water and favorable weather. Lord, in your mercy, for the nations. Empower leaders to work for the well-being of all. Send peace into every place where people live in the shadow of violence and displacement. Free all who are isolated behind walls of fear. Lord, in your mercy. For those in need, look with compassion toward those who bear hidden wounds. Draw near to those who seek you. Comfort the dying, console the grieving, and heal the sick. Especially we pray for those we name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, for this assembly, give us courage to welcome newcomers graciously. Walk with those who are inquiring, those who harbor doubts and questions, and those who are absent from us. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. With thanksgiving, we remember those who have died in faith. Inspire us by their witness. Bring us with them to the heavenly feast. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Joining our voices with your faithful ones in every time and place, we offer our prayers in the name of the risen one, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share the gift of peace.
We pray together. Be known to us, O Lord, in the breaking of the bread, as you were made known to the disciples. Receive these gifts and the offering of our lives, that we may be your risen body in the world. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter, and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. By your great mercy, we have been born anew to a living hope through the resurrection of your Son from the dead and to an inheritance which is unfading. Once we were no people, but now we are your people, declaring your wonderful deeds in Christ, who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. When the Lord ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. And in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." On the day you raised him from the dead, he was recognized by his disciples in the breaking of the bread. And in the power of your Holy Spirit, your church has continued in the breaking of the bread and the sharing of the cup. So in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of our faith, Christ has died. Christ is risen. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. We join with one another as a family of faith. We pray in the words that our Savior taught. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
May be seated.
Let us feast this Easter Sunday on Christ, the bread of heaven. Alleluia. May the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. We pray together. Life-giving God, in the mystery of Christ's death and resurrection, you send light to conquer darkness, water to give new life, the bread of heaven to nourish your people. Send us forth as witnesses to Jesus' resurrection, that we may show your glory to all the world through the same Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Now may God, who has brought us from death to life, fill you with great joy. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Christ is risen. Raised up for the world. Go in peace. Share the good news.
Thank you for worshiping with us at St. Paul's Lutheran Church. For more information about our church, to listen to previous episodes, or to find our Facebook and Twitter pages, please go to www.stpaulsgi.com.